أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن تبعه وأهلاه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. إن شاء الله we continue resume our Seerah sessions after رمضان العيد. May Allah accept from all of us بإذن الله تعالى. last session, just remind everybody that we were talking about the stage of Mecca, you know, the preparation to go to Medina, the Hijra to Medina. We talked about the first migration to Habasha and how it was, and some of the reasons and the circumstances at that time. And we talked about the Bay'ah or the pledge of Al-Aqaba, first one and second one. And last thing we talked about is the lessons that we learn from the second bay'ah, which was 70 plus from Al-Ansar. Al-Aws and Al-Khazraj, they were two tribes in Medina fighting with each other. The year before, few of them accepted Islam. The following year, more people, men and women, went over there. Al-Khazraj is a bigger tribe than Al-Aws. Khazraj, bigger tribe than Aus. Yani three times more even in those who were giving bay'ah to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That's why Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam appointed 11 naqib or representatives. Not appointed, he told them to choose each family or each clan, choose one from them to become representatives. Yani make the decisions, lead them, communicate with Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and so on. So there were three from Al-Aws and nine from Al-Khazraj. That shows, you know, the proportions there. Few of the lessons before we enter to the Medina stage. Few of the lessons that we learn from this bay'ah. Bay'ah, yani pledge, pledge of allegiance to Rasulullah, to Allah, tab'an, to the religion of Islam. To Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as the prophet, as the messenger, as the representative of this deen, as the leader. So this was like the main victory for al-Islam. Why it is the main victory for Islam? Somebody said, oh, there was no encounters, nothing yet. But this is the seed, this is the beginning, this is the foundation. For everything comes after. These people, these men, these women, they have to be specific quality. Right? They're ready to give everything without hesitation for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So anybody comes after them owes them. Even us sitting here today, we owe those sahaba of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam who went against all odds, against the whole world, against the culture, against the tradition, against all Arabia, and they knew that they would face the whole world. Can you imagine that? Can you imagine this in your head? And they are just few. It's not like an army of people or something. It's just few people. They had that conviction. So this is different type of human beings. No doubt. Right? There is no doubt about it. So every Muslim owes them something. And that's why this is the main victory of Islam, because this is the beginning. On their shoulders, everything comes after that. Muhajireen, of course. But this Ansar are the ones who took it to the next level. Muhajirin gave up everything to migrate to Medina, as we'll see in a minute. But Al-Ansar gave up also everything to face the whole world for the sake of Allah Azza wa Jal and to support His Messenger Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. So that faith, that Iman yani has to, we can talk about it forever, right? But just trying to get a glimpse of it. Also, the from that we understand that the leadership in any community is a reflection of how ready is that community. How? One of two ways. The leader introduces some idea to the community, and because they trust that leader so much, they follow it. So that is showing us, this shows us the importance of the quality of the leader. Right? We as a community choose a leader with a certain quality. So when they introduce new ideas, for us, we trust them so much. So that's very important. The choice is very important. That's one way. The other way, the community also produces the leader based on what the community looks like. Okay? So if you find community who are masjid-oriented, you will always find the leader masjid-oriented. If you find the community secular, you find their leader secular. If you find the community indifferent, they don't care, that means any leader can come. Maybe they are fortunate enough that a good leader will come, because they don't care anyways, right? But most likely, it's not going to happen. It's not going to happen, right? Most likely, someone will come out as a result of this, and then we cry later on. Okay? So this is very, very important. This bay'ah also shows us that these people, they were the best representative of their community, and when they took the message, they took it sincerely, and it affected that community. Now, also, it shows us how the planning of Rasulullah ﷺ from one side and the planning of Al-Ansar from the other side, right? They were coming among 500 people. So they were secretly moving around, and Rasulullah ﷺ, you know, meeting with them in a certain place like that. So it's very important also to have planned, and that plan can be open or secret. You have to share it or not share it, with whom you share it. All this also we understand in the early time of Al-Islam. Now, also choosing, we talked about this, but I'm just picking up from there. Choosing the last day of Tashriq. You know, after Hajj, there are 3 days, Ayyam al-Tashriq. 11, 12, 13, whoever went to Hajj, you know, we throw Jamarat on the 11th and the 12th, and you have the choice to stay the 13th or not. So the bay'ah happened on the 13th night. Why? I mean the 12 at night, yani 13 is the next day. When we say 13th night, means 12 at night, right? 12th of the Hijjah at night, means tomorrow is the last day. People throw Jamarat and then they leave to their towns. And that was the point. So they make the bay'ah, and in the morning, kullu yamshi, everybody leaves. So what happened, this and that, is too late already. And that's exactly what happened. Okay? Because everybody, so that shows also, yani some people think that, oh, Rasulullah Muhammad, that Muhammad, I'm talking yani about non-Muslims, yani, right? Or someone, oh, he's an Arab Bedouin in the desert, who are people who only know the camel and the goats. And but actually, when you read in the Seerah, you see yani the steps that he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the Sahaba followed, and the plans, this can be taught in universities. No exaggeration, right? Everything was planned, accounted for, who's going to do this, what's going to do that, and why to choose this, that, and who's appointed, and who's the contact person, and where to meet, and how to give the news. It was not just a joke. It is not just normal people like that. They were smart. They were chosen by Allah Azza wa Jal, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Abu Jahl was not a stupid person. Abu Lahab was not a stupid person. There's two different things between somebody stupid and somebody intelligent but deviated. Right? Two different things. Yani the thief who robs the bank is not stupid. He's very intelligent. But using the intelligence in a wrong way, they don't have the cause, or they don't have the goal, and they don't have, no, they choose the wrong, to choose the intelligence in the wrong way. Okay? And this is, subhanAllah, to pray to Allah Azza wa Jal to always give us the basira. You know, basira means the ability to discern and choose the right thing. Because you can have the basar very 20-20 eyesight. 20-20 eyesight does not mean you're going to enjoy everything you're seeing. Would it mean that? Somebody have 20-20 eyesight, and you take them to a beautiful scenery, mountains and beautiful things. Oh yeah, finish. or you take them to a natural, you know, resort or something like that in the Caribbean or something, they see everything. They see far more than you, further than you. But subhanAllah, you look around, you see a shell on the beach, and it makes your day. Beautiful, Layla. So look at the water and washing this and that, you know? So this is basira. What is this called? Basira. So you can see little, but everything makes sense to you and it affects your soul. Somebody can see a lot of things, but it doesn't mean anything. Somebody eats a little bit and enjoy the taste of the food. Somebody you give them and they keep eating, but there is no enjoyment for the food. Somebody's clothes, mashallah, you know, two or three different sets of clothes, but they take care of them and mashallah, they look good on them. Somebody have like a wardrobe full of clothes, but they doesn't mean anything. You understand the parables here I'm trying to give? So that is the basira, subhanallah. So the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, sahaba al-kiram, all these people, they were intelligent. The intelligence, when it has the noor of al-Iman, mashallah. The intelligence, when it does not have the noor of al-Iman, it destroys the person. Does not help. Does not help. Yeah. Also, the statement of the bay'ah itself. You know, in America here, when you make agreement, they said make sure it's contract. That's number one, right? Make sure you have an agreement. That's number one. Whenever you're going to do something, make sure it is what? Agreement format. Number two, make sure it is written. Number three, make sure the language helps you in what you want. Yes? Those three main conditions in any agreement. Muhammad, would you do this for me? Yeah, inshallah, Sheikh. There is no agreement here. It's just word and oral agreement, but there was no emphasis there, no details. So that is first step. I need such and such. Would you do it? Yes, I will do it. That's an agreement, right? Now, how are we going to do it? We meet tomorrow at the masjid at that time and let's talk about it, right? So let's write that down. And then we write it down so I don't assume wrong and he does not misunderstand what I'm saying. Because I thought you meant to help you and I did not know that you wanted me for 1 hour. Yeah? So then we have a problem now. So he agreed to help. He knows that he's going to record the lecture, but he does not know that I'm going to talk forever. Okay? So you need that written. I need you to come tomorrow, Thursday, after Maghrib. We're going to have a lecture for 1 hour. Let's write that down. Okay? Now we're going to write down what equipment he's going to use, how I'm going to talk, from what angle he will do, as much as we can. Make sense now? That? Now how can we apply this to the bay'ah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? What does he want bay'ah for? He just wants new recruits to become Muslims? Those are the recruits. This is the foundation. So he wants to be very precise on what he says. He says, you are going to give me bay'ah when you are at time of activity, when you are time of not activity, and when you are strong, when you are weak. No excuse, huh? Don't tell me, oh, we are tired today. Oh, there is a fever. Oh, we are sick. You know, can we delay this? Well, I have been Israel as a role model, right? So pay attention to that. So, في المنشط ويعني والكسل. في النشاط والكسل. So, you're going to be active at the time. You're going to help at the time when you are active or when you are not active. You will do as much as you can. That actually made a difference. Why? Because see Battle of Uhud, مثلاً. Battle of Uhud. What happened in Battle of Uhud? There was a big defeat, right? Big defeat. 70 were killed and many of them were injured and ran away from the battlefield. Yes? But subhanallah, when they reach Medina, Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, when the people of Quraysh sent to scare Rasulullah and the Sahaba, we are going to come and finish you up. We're going to finish what we started. You know, when the kuffar of Mecca left Uhud, they reached to, close to Mecca, they said, what did we do? We did not kill Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We did not capture any of them, and we did not enter or take over Medina. So what basically did we do? You see? وَلَقَدْ صَرَفَكُمْ عَنْهُمْ لِيَبْتَلِيَكُمْ. So Allah Azza wa Jal, يعني make you go and make them go and everybody, like later on they think, what happened? So they said, okay, if we go now, maybe they get ready, but we want to scare them off anyways. So they sent someone to Rasulullah, said, you know what, Quraysh went to bring more reinforcement and they will come and take over Medina this time. Allah mentioned that in Surah Al-Imran. الَّذِينَ قَالَ لَهُمُ النَّاسُ إِنَّ النَّاسَ قَدَ جَمَعُوا لَكُمْ فَخْشَوْهُمْ. People gather for you, so be afraid. فَزَادَهُمْ إِيمَانًا. They increase their iman. وَقَالُوا حَسْبُنَ اللَّهُ وَنِعْمَ الْوَكِيلُ. But my quote here, why I'm quoting this? Because bay'ah here reflected on Uhud. So in the bay'ah, he said, you are going to give up your, you are going to sacrifice yourself, whether you are physically able or not able. So Rasulullah ﷺ said, we are going to go back again and meet them. We are going to go back again and meet them. And only those who were fighting with me. Nobody knew. Only those who were in the battlefield, they are the one who are going to fight again. So the Sahaba saying, some of us were not able even to mount the horse or the camel. That's how badly injured they were. But people carry them. You know, they were carried. Imagine killing someone on the ground and two, three people have to carry them to mount them on the horse, to sit them on it. يعني. That is what bay'ah was talking about. You get it? So the bay'ah is talking about means no excuse here. And that is the leadership. Leadership, right? So they went back and they camped in a place called Hamra al-Asad for 3 days and they told Mecca, come, we're waiting for you. So the people in Mecca, they are the ones who did not come, did not respond. So all Arabia now, they said, you know what? Muhammad is the one who won, not the Mecca. That's why Allah Azza wa Jalla said, فَانْقَلَبُوا بِنِعْمَةٍ مِّنَ اللَّهِ وَفَضْلٍ لَمْ يَمْسَسْهُمْ سُوءٌ وَاتَّبَعُوا رِضْوَانَ اللَّهِ. So the defeat became what? Victory. That part of Uhud is very important. But that part goes way back to that bay'ah. Now you understand, right? The importance of a contract. You get idea now why I was talking about this contract? That is the importance. So when we say, make sure there is a contract, make sure there is detail, make sure there is agreement, that is an Islamic principle. It is an Islamic principle. Why Allah Azza wa Jalla said, when somebody borrows, make sure there are two witnesses and writing. It's not about embarrassment. It's not about that. Money changes people. Money changes good people. Right? And if there is no agreement, shaitan can come and make good people not so good people. Right? That's why Allah Azza wa Jalla said, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا إِذَا تَدَيَّنْتُمْ بِدَيْنٍ إِلَىٰ أَجَلٍ مُسَمًّا فَاكْتُبُوهُ. Allah is talking to الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا, يعني those who believe. So when we have a financial transaction, when I tell you, let's write it down, it is not about me mistrusting you here. No, it's not about that. When somebody asking for a loan, alhamdulillah, if I'm able to give you a loan, I want it to be written. I want two witnesses. Don't say, oh no, I don't want anybody to know. La, la, ya akhi, that is the deen. This is the deen of Rabbul Alameen. It's not about you and me now. It is about Allah telling us a system. We follow the system. Mafhoom, ya akhwan? It's very important to surrender to the religion like this. Otherwise, when our habits or our culture or our tradition interfere, then the deen becomes customized and becomes, then it's never good. It's not good. It will come on the challenge, then there will be always issues. Because your culture is different from my culture, your expectation is different from my expectation, then it defeats the purpose. What is the purpose? In Rabbul Alameen, Rabbul Alameen subhanahu wa ta'ala is putting a system that everybody abides by. Khalas. That's it. When we pray jama'ah, we have to make this line like this. So if somebody does not like a row, he wants to make it like vertical, you cannot do that. So it's not about what you like now. There is a certain way to do it. There is a certain time to do it. We all agree. عشان كده احنا بنتفق في العبادات. انت طواف, tawaf, people have to go in a certain way. If somebody goes because they feel to go opposite, it's not going to work. That's why we agree. And that should bring our agreement outside as well. But unfortunately, this step needs lots of training. Yeah. Like we agreed to sit in the masjid, we should agree also to deal outside with each other with the way of Rabbul Alam. So that agreement was very important. So they give the bay'ah to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Now there is no battery in this one as well. بعد رمضان بقى, you know, يعني the battery issue after Ramadan. حد يشوف لنا الموضوع ده يا اخوانا ولا؟ شوفوا لنا الباتري يا اخوانا. The battery. نعم. We need to have a contract for that one. I figure, see another one over here? No? No problem, inshallah. If everybody's sitting here, خلاص, no problem, inshallah. Now this one, inshallah. Okay, is this one? Okay, let me. All right, so now we talked about obedience. At the time of being active or physically, you're gonna be ready, conditioned mentally that you want to obey. So your state of mind or your physical state, secondary. واضح يا اخوانا في الطاعة, طاعة الله ورسوله. طاعة الله ورسوله is not based on your convenience. That is a very essential agreement here between you and Allah Azza wa Jal. It's not about your convenience. That's why Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, if people know what is in Salat al-Jama'ah and the first line and Takbirat al-Ihram, they will come even crawling. What did he mean by that? That's what he means. Now understand this bay'ah here? يعني you are going to obey Allah and His Rasul regardless. Why we say that? That means my physical ability comes secondary. يعني I will do my best until I'm not able. I'm not able anymore. When you go exercise, subhanAllah, the best of trainers who charge thousands of dollars, what they do? What they do? They push the person hard. And when they are about to give up, said, one more. He tell you, that one is the one. That is me. That means what? You went beyond what you thought you can do. That's why in the salah, we say sometimes, extend your ruku'ah. Extend your sujood. See how you can do. Now in your head, know what? I can do better. So next time, you are going to push even more. In the sadaqah, you know what? Today, inshallah, I'm going to give $10. Make them $10.50. Put another dollar at the time of spending. You know what? When you get 10, last time I gave 11, and it was easy. It was not bad, nothing. So inshallah, it will become 15 after that. عشان كده الصحابة, if they don't have money to give sadaqah, they go work hard so they can give sadaqah. Imagine that. So it's not about convenience. It's not about, you know what, I don't have, I should receive sadaqah. It doesn't work like this. They know that the upper hand is better than the lower hand. They don't want to be lower hand. Salah, same thing. Zakah, same thing. Hajj, same thing. Quran, same thing. Birrul walidain, same thing. Dealing with each other, same thing. Always you want more. That's why the bay'ah was very precise. You are going to obey Allah and His Rasul at the time when you want or when you don't want. At the time when you are active or when you are tired. At the time when you are rich or when you are poor. You're going to obey Allah and His Rasul. So no excuses. Is not convenient religion. It's not a religion based on your convenience. It is a religion to make a better person out of you and me. If we follow convenience, then it's no good. The problem is, masjid is full based on people's convenience. And that's not good. It's not good. I want to be in the masjid because I'm benefiting from that. Because it makes me a better person. I feel better when I'm in the masjid, in the house of Allah. I fully charge when I come to the masjid, or I'm leaving, when I'm driving my car, I'm like a king or someone who just received a gift. So I'm looking forward next time to go to the masjid. That's why it's not convenient. I'm tired, coming back from work tired, or you know what, yeah, I have a little headache now. It doesn't work like that. Now we understand why this bay'ah was very important, right? It was very precise and very important because of that. And the Ansar, they responded to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam exactly. And they, subhanAllah, followed exactly what Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam told them. Also from the benefits of this bay'ah, everyone before have an idea about leadership or have an entitlement. Okay, this one is the leader of Al-Aws, this one is the leader of Al-Khazraj. Huh? This one is the leader of this clan, and this one is the leader of that clan. That one has that status, this one has that status. Now when they give bay'ah to Rasulullah, they were forfeited everything actually. من القائد الآن؟ النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. Who is our leader in all affairs? Rasulullah. خلاص. Everybody now, back off. And that's what Islam does. That's what Islam does, subhanAllah. Now if you carry that with you in the service of the deen of Allah, we will have a problem. Leadership or administrative leadership or social leadership or political leadership or whatever leadership, it's fine. But when the order of Allah and His Rasul comes, everybody comes under that. So you don't carry that status with you. You don't carry that status with you. So Sayyidina Abu Bakr is the Khalifa of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He had a certain status here, right? But when the affairs of the Muslimin, he is like anybody of them. Actually, he'll consider himself the least. Sayyidina Umar, same thing, because they understood that principle. Okay, understand that. Yes, you are there, our administrator, you are our Amir in a certain level, right? But it does not mean you are a better mu'min than us, or you are entitled something than us. You cannot claim that. You cannot claim that. Okay, we sit and eat together. We all sit together. Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, "Ana akulu kama ya'kulu al-'abd." I eat like a slave, like, you know, and drink like. He said, humble. If somebody come Arabi, from the first look, he does not know who's Rasulullah from the rest, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. See. So that is in the affairs. But when it comes to the teaching of the deen, he is Rasulullah. He is the one who received the wahi through Jibreel alayhi salam. That's that level, right? But when he humbles himself down, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, to show us. So everybody is not a leader in front of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. All of them are sahaba al-kiram, all of them. Any status is given for a purpose. When they lead the army, oh, Khalid ibn Walid is in the front. Khalid ibn Walid is in the front. Now in the front of Rasulullah, kullu sawa. But when they go to the army, said, who's your leader? Osama ibn Zayd, 16 year old. So everybody is a soldier. Wadih? Clear? So that is the Islam, right? When we appoint someone for it, we have to respect that one. We cannot just keep revolting and doing and this. No. You're going to respect that. Why? Because Allah Azza wa Jalla is teaching us to be the deen of discipline and organization and structure. We know that the bay'ah was by Rasulullah extending his hand and the men shaking the hand of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And that was even in America they call it a shake hand deal, right? Until recently that was actually binding by law in America here. Like 100 years ago it was binding by law. If we say sell me this land and you say I sold it to you, how much? You give me $10. And they put their hands together, that's the signature right there. And people saw that, that's a shake hand deal. They will go in the county or the sheriff or something and he will stamp it right there when he said, yeah, they shook hand. Okay, so the bay'ah was like that. So it's not a strange thing. It's actually a human trait, right? So as I extend his hand, and the Sahabi, after he heard, you're going to give me bay'ah for such and such, you agree? One by one comes and they put their hand on the source. Can be for that person or whoever he is representing. So the bay'ah does not have to be every single person. Okay, it has to be the one who they represent. And this is where this election and the representatives and the area code, zip code and all, this is where it comes from. So we have this origin of that in Naqib, Nuqaba. And Sayyidina Musa, على فكرة, اختار موسى قومه 70 رجلا لميقاتنا. Yani he chose 70 people as naqib, right? Also, he chose 12 from the 12 tribes, right? Each 12 spring of water, 12 this, 12 that, okay? So 12 people also, and Rasulullah ﷺ chose as well, same. Now, also we learned that women played a very important role in this. They were not alienated from the beginning of Islam, subhanAllah. Whether what was in Mecca, the first woman died fi sabil, the first person who died fi sabilillah was a woman. The first shaheed in Islam who died because of the religion of the deen, because la ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah was not a man in the battlefield. It was a woman, Sumayya, the mother of Ammar ibn Yasir. Abu Jahl killed her, right? And then he killed the father after that. So yani, women from the beginning of the deen, from the first seed, women were around. Who was the first one who believed in la ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah? Who? Here you go, Khadija radiallahu anha. So nobody can just put women like and say women in the back. Back what? You don't get it. Okay? And we can talk about it forever, yani, this one. First one who said la ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah without doubt and supported Rasulullah by all means was a woman. The first one who died for that religion and gave her life without hesitation was a woman. Yes. And the one who taught one third of this deen from Rasulullah was also a woman, Aisha radiallahu anha. Who else? There was no one single man who gave another third, yani. Mafish. Yani there was, yani if we say Islam is three thirds, and one third said Aisha give, the other two thirds we cannot say there is one man here and one man, there is nobody like that. Yani they share everything. You know, all the Sahaba, the two thirds came from too many people, but one third came from one woman. And now when we talk, we say women behind, women front, or rijal above, mafish understanding. Yani you have to really get that in perspective. You have to get it in context. You have to get it what? In context. Another example I give you to make it clear, yani. When there is a father and a son walking together, who walks in the front and who walks in the back? It depends, right? It depends. Some people will say the father walks the front out of respect. But what if you see the son walking in the front? Sometimes he walks in the front to make sure that the father doesn't get harmed, right? To make the way in front of the father out of respect as well. So it does not mean anything. It does not mean the son walking in the front, he's better than his father. And it doesn't mean that the father is leading means he's always the case. So we have to understand what happens here, right? So when Allah Azza wa Jalla give a man a status or a level, it does not mean that he is like better, okay? Or that he is superior and the woman inferior. Or this is first class citizenship and this is second class citizenship. That is the misunderstanding we're bringing the ummah behind. Yeah. This is what it is. Okay? Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the leader, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But his wives, while he's fighting, they give the drinks to the sahaba, the men, yani men who are injured, who is nursing patching their wounds and giving them water in their mouth, putting in their mouth. Who? Women. Sayyidah Aisha radiallahu anha used to do it. Sayyidah Ummu Salama used to do it. Here is the community of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. By our standards, that's a very liberal community. If we think about it, yani, right? But dressed properly, fee level, there is a necessity, there is emergency here, there are certain standards for everything. But sometimes you go to a place and it is for the sake of it, for the sake of it, that we have to segregate. We have to put a partition, like if we can make a hole in the wall to put the partition up, floors up yani, as well, for the sake of it. And we forget why we are putting the partition. No, we focus on the partition itself, how thick it is, how big it is, soundproof or not, big or not, you can see through or not, that's what we focus on. But why we put it there is not the issue anymore. That's a fixture we have. We need a fixture here. Like carpet became very important in a masjid. But why we put the carpet? محج بفكر. Nobody think why. Why the lights? Why this? But we focus on what? How this, that, long, big, you know, we have to look this and the carpet red, or green, or pattern, or no pattern. Distraction. I'm not putting any of this and say don't do it. I'm not saying that. I'm saying fine, but know why you are doing it. Because when you answer why, then you will do what is best. When we go to the why we're doing things, then we will do what is best. What is best? And if in time of war, people injured, and the men are fighting, so who's going to take care of the wounded? Women. But if somebody come as a guest, the woman is not going to go and put the drink in his mouth, يعني, in the house. Would she do that? Same man. يعني, same man who was injured in the Battle of Uhud, there was one of the women giving water in his mouth. يعني, of course, she would be holding his head or that, something like that. But if he is, mashallah, good and strong, and he's coming to visit her husband at home, would she come out and put water in his mouth? Give him an apple, يعني, feed him? ينفع, يعني. So that means why it is done. So don't misquote things, and don't forget why, and focus on how. Too much, huh? They are very important. So also we learn the women's role at the time of the beginning of this deen, when it's going to launch to become a state in Medina. Okay? So that was in Mecca, Khadija radiallahu anha, the Sahaba of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, each one of course supported by his wife, etc., etc., right? But in Medina now, Al-Ansar is showing another standard also, that women were part of it. So don't say, women stays home all the time, women do that. La, ya akhwan. The woman came from Yathrib, from Medina, to give bay'ah to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They also gave. Yeah, he did not shake their hand, yes. But they were there present. They were present. And they were proud of it. They were proud of it. And they were fighting also in the war if they were able to. Even it is not a must on them. And Rasulullah didn't say, what you doing here? Go hide. He did not do that. He let a woman defend him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Okay? So, yeah, we tell women to pray at home. But if they want to come to the masjid, ya Allah, bismillah, welcome. And we can make accommodation as well. Yes. So our deen is the deen of understanding. And it starts from that time of the bay'ah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Subhanallah. Those they were very truthful with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They were truthful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Those 73 who gave bay'ah to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, 1/3 of them, mostly, yani 1/3 of them, they died as a shaheed at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And half of them, they attended every single encounter with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam against anybody else. So 33 was always with Rasulullah, from Badr all the way until Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam passed away. They were with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That tells you how truthful they were and how eager they were. طبعاً the others, that means they died as a shuhada, يعني in the way. Or they died as a shuhada after Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now, migrating to Al-Madinah. What time is Isha? 50? 50, يعني, okay. Migrating to Medina, it is not like Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told the Sahaba, go to Habasha because there is a just king over there. Now Medina is not like that. Medina did not have a just king over there. This is Arabia, same culture, same traditions. Arab bardu, Ubad Authan, the Ahl Mecca. And they used to worship idols as well. There was Jews over there. So it's different setting. Different setting. So he allowed the Sahaba to go there, but is not going there for protection. Like Al-Habasha. They're going there for establishment. Okay? To prepare the way, to pave the way to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam for establishment of the deen. So that's, the preparation has to be different, right? That's why Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was the last at the end, after everybody goes, or most they go. And then this was not like a picnic or like we try out things. Nah, there has to be some preparation before they go. And that preparation took 13 years actually. كل ال 13 سنة دي يعني عشان that moment. يعني all these 13 years were for that moment. Now I understand the perspective, right? Why they had to go through all this torture, why they have to go through this persecution. They have to learn how to give up everything. So when they have resources, it does not distract them. Yes? So they have to lose everything. So when you get everything, it does not distract you. And actually, when you survey the history of Islam, you will find that it reaches the top when this is the case. When the Muslims' generation grown, that they were under so much persecution that they'll basically give up everything. Right? So they reach the top, even when they have the whole dunya, does not affect. When they started being distracted with the dunya, the curve goes down. Ala tool, you see it in the history, never misses. Never misses. They were like that in Mecca. When they went to Medina, what happened? Establishment up. Then after that, they kept going, 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 growing, right? Once they settled, and then the dunya started, who's going to be the king, who's going to be the khalifa, who's going to be the leader, who's going to, right? Then the comes down. Then when the generation comes up again, the deen of Allah and the ulama started working and raising generation who give up everything for the sake of Allah, they go up again. And then now that's why we are in the bottom now. We are rock bottom. Why? Because no respect for any leadership. Everyone عنده fatwa, where everyone knows, where everyone understands everything, where everyone can read Quran, where everybody can make tafsir, where everybody can say, oh, this hadith is okay, this hadith is not okay. I just take the Quran, forget about the sunnah. Who is that Bukhari and Muslim? What is Abu Hanifa? What is Malik? You know, when you have that, means you are hitting rock bottom. And now actually digging even worse, more yani. And you reach the bottom, but you're not satisfied. We keep digging actually more. Right? So this is what happens. Then the ummah will grow up again. This is the last curve, by the way. Yani. What is remaining is the last curve going up. That's it. We already reached enough down. Yani. خلاص مفيش. ندعو الله عز وجل ان احنا we started going up. مفيش any more bottom. Yani. We already reached. Alhamdulillah. So we ask Allah عز وجل not to stay there for long. Yeah, because the next step is the curve, and this is the last curve, as Rasulullah mentioned. ثم خلافة على منهاج النبوة. It has to come. And this chaos will be followed by good, inshallah, Rabbil Alameen. So we pray to Allah Azza wa Jal to make us and our children, our grandchildren, this ummah بإذن الله تعالى. We pray to Allah Azza wa Jal for that. So this has to, this raising or tarbiyah of Rasulullah and tazkiyah of Rasulullah started from early on. And that's why it paid off for the hijrah to Medina. Also the Quran style, the Quran Makki, as I'll give you an image now to relate to inshallah, right? Quran al-Makki has a certain style. I want you to think about it like a wheel. You know the wheel? Not the wheel of fortune, huh? Just a wheel. You know the wheel? There is a wheel, عجلة يعني, أمامك كده. Allah Azza wa Jal sending revelation to one prophet from human being for the guidance of human being so they become ready for the interview with Allah. إِلَيْهِ يُرْجَعُونَ. Allah created us. We are down on earth. So He's sending us what guides us. Choose a prophet from among us. رَسُولًا مِنْ أَنفُسِهِمْ. And that guidance to guide us in this dunya. Why? So when we stand in front of Allah, we know what to say. Is that image simple? Very simple image. And that's Quran al-Makki. هو القرآن المكي كذا. خلي بالك خلي الصورة دي في ذهنك تفهم كل القرآن المكي بإذن الله تعالى. Always. You will find the Quran al-Makki talking about Allah. إن إلهكم لواحد. قل هو الله أحد. قل يا أيها الكافرون لا أعبد ما تعبدون. صح؟ قرآن مكي. Always. في جنات Finnar, Jahannam, Al Kuffar, you know, always like that. The people before, Qawm Nuh, Qawm Lut, always talking about things to connect you with who? With Allah Azza wa Jal. So Allah Azza wa Jal sending the message to the, and the, then the Quran Makki talking about the message as guidance. Quran Al Makki talking about the Prophet. In Ana illa Nadir, Bashirun wa Nadir, like that. And then guiding the human being, telling them Jannah and Hellfire. You do good, you don't do. General, huh? General message. And then Yawm Al-Qiyamah, وَاتَّقُوا يَوْمًا تُرْجَعُونَ فِيهِ اللَّهِ. This is Surah Al-Baqarah, the end, yeah. But in all the Quran Al-Makki emphasizing on that. So you will see, read the surahs, you will find always this circle like this. Quran Al-Madani, on the other side, you know, is not a flow chart, but it is one type of chart. You see Allah Azza wa Jal, you know, and then you will find some rays coming down, okay? One is to you're explaining your relationship with Allah Azza wa Jalla. That is the details of Aqeedah now. What to believe, what not to believe, details, more details, right? And then how we worship Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. Salah wa siyam wa zakah wa hajj, and this is where the fiqh comes and all of that, right? And then mu'amalat, how to deal with each other and all of this. And then the akhlaq, how to behave in morals and manners. So Quran al-Madani is always like that. So Quran al-Madani, everything is to connect you to Allah, but in a practical manner. Ma'isha يعني. يعني how you do it in your hayah, in your life. That is Madani Quran. Makki Quran is to build this one. And to connect this one with an image. في يوم القيامة, خلي بالك. Right? These people were bad, في يوم القيامة جهنم. These people were good, في يوم القيامة إيه؟ Jannah. Quran al-Makki is to build that aqeedah strong. So when the dunya comes, I don't get distracted now. I have mu'amalat, la fi halal, haram. I'm gonna eat like this, I'm gonna behave like that. This is marriage, this is talaq, this is that, right? But the Makki one is foundation first. So that's like a wheel, and this one is like umbrella, right? And you know, branches coming off. If you have that image in your head when you're reading Quran, then you'll understand. That's what we teach our youth. When we say there is halal and haram, because they are not getting that image, and the Makki Quran is not getting there, it becomes a duty and the burden. Why everything is haram like that? Why too many duties? But the one who have this Makki style already planted, they love Rabbul Alameen, they love Allah. بحب ربنا. Loves Allah, cries for Allah, cries with the khushu' of Allah Azza wa Jal. When they're alone, they're afraid from Allah Azza wa Jal to be angry, afraid of Allah to be angry. Then when they come to salah, it's not a duty now. It's a tool that serves that love. Huh? Yes, so it's not a duty. And that's why the aqeedah is important in the children's life. It is very important. We always care, oh, grab the children, bring them to the masjid. Go to the sheikh, sit 1 hour in the office, think he's going to give you the magic potion. Boom, the kids become good. It does not work like that. It does not work like this. It works many other ways. It starts from you at home, the mom at home. How they communicate at home with each other. They see the father waking up early morning, making wudu and praying fajr. Huh? So it's not a duty, it's part of life. They see that they're doing that all the time. They know that they need the $10 from the dad who prays. They know that I have to do that to get that as well. It all grows package, yani. Package deal. But if father or mother always busy with the dunya and expect their children to come, zay, yani how it's gonna come? Father shouts all the time and talk negatively or badly with his wife and expect the kids to become calm يعني, when they grow. ازاي يعني تمشي ازاي دي? How? Or indifferent. Father does not care about salah, يصلي ما يصليش هو حر. And then you know when the kids grow and they do haram, they come and say, why? Why? I did everything for my children. Wallah, every money, house, the cars, everything, sheikh, but why the kids are dead? I said, because of what you just said. Because you actually did everything except what you were supposed to do. Because you did everything, that's why they didn't do anything. Because you did not do the one thing that will make them do what you want them to do now. Yeah. We care about their intelligence in the math and science, about their body and how much Allah kida yani halwa kida muscular, but we don't care about their soul or their spirit. The connection with the masjid and the jama'ah, we don't give that a priority. That needs to have a priority. Balance. That's why you find, subhanAllah, many of the religious community, not those who are overzealous, many religious communities, you find their kids successful, very successful. They have their school, they have their system. You find the kids, they are the ones who lead later. You know what I'm talking about, right? Like that. Alhamdulillah, we have Islamic schools, but it need to fit in a vision. And grab it away and save it from all this politics and who's doing what, and this is Pakistani, this is Arab, this is... Please, yani, right? This is a jewel. It need to be served as such. Not throw it kada anywhere. That's a gift from Rabbil Alameen that we are able to build an Islamic school. But that Islamic school need actually to be for Muslim children. We need to get over that, ikhwanna, wallahi. And I can talk, and this is a very deep thing in my heart, yani. When I see Islamic schools, they are not dealt with as Islamic schools. And nobody should blame anybody. We all blame each other. All of us are blamed here. Huh? Schools should have a waqf, millions and millions of dollars of waqf, which we have. We have it. It's not like we don't have. We should have those millions of dollars. Awqaf, that all the money comes and the children come for free. Everybody. All the Muslim children enter the Islamic school. It has to be the alternative. It is not a privilege, Yaquan. It is unfortunately a privilege. Unfortunately, it is a privilege for certain people only who can give money. And those who give money, not everybody, subhanAllah, is having the vision. They think by the money they can control the decision and they control how it is done. Then we defeat the purpose. And I'm sorry to say that, but that's the case. Yani. 20 years I'm seeing it all the time. And I will speak about it openly in front of you. People put money in the school and think they control everybody. And if they don't control, they will pull the money. School fails. You see, the equation itself is wrong. The equation itself is wrong. And when you pull your money and the school fails, then you're happy now? You are not afraid from Rabbil Alameen subhanahu wa ta'ala. You stand in front of him, and because of you, 10, 15, 20 children lost Islamic education because you just said, I'm paying 50,000 every year and I'm going to pull him if you don't do that. La. That's why the bay'ah of Rasulullah was very precise in the beginning. See, I sometimes don't control my emotions, but I hope you understand where I'm coming from. Yani. I'm not meaning anybody in particular or anything. I am part of the community. I have my own faults too. But Islamic schools, believe me, it is not looked at as such. It is a piece or a game or a field for politics, unfortunately, or for social and culture and ethnic things. And it is, but looked as a madrasa of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That was the madrasa of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to prepare his sahaba kiram. Right? Islamic school should have no fees attached to it like the Muslim burial place. That's my own conviction. Yani. Education for Muslims in America, and when they die to be buried, they should not pay any fees. There should be no fees. Then it becomes an alternative, right? Why I take my children out while I'm having math, science, lab, everything, top of the line. Wallahi, I swear by Rabbil Alameen, you will find non-Muslim kids coming to your school and lining up for it. I swear by Rabbil Alameen, you will find that. I saw by my own eyes many Christians of this country, good people, they are coming to Islamic school and they put their children there. And make their children wallahi memorize Quran. And I witness myself, some who said, if my child grow as a Muslim, good. You see, that is the model, ikhwan, we want. We want that. We want a waqf kabir, businesses dedicated for Islamic schools. So no fundraising, nothing like that. We don't want to have that. So I want my children, by default, they enter kindergarten, Islamic environment. That's what we should have, right? until they get to college. And also we have college that teaches psychology and medicine and all of that. Why not? Why not? Harvard have billions of dollars in awqaf. Why? This is the only university that was established before the establishment of America itself. يعني ما كانش في حاجة اسمها أمريكا. There was no such a thing called the United States before Harvard. See how important education when it's established like that. So when they graduate, millions of dollars comes because they're successful people. Model, right? This is a model. So inshallah, رب العالمين, we pray to Allah Azza wa Jal to give us this vision that our Islamic education, especially in this land, becomes for free. For free. Islamic education. For free. The imams of the masajid should have support from awqaf so they can teach, and everybody's for free. Any alim comes and sits, their life and their material life is taken care of in such a way that they are not humiliated or looked down upon as employees or something. No. They are our ulama, our teachers. Then you will find people competing to become imams like they're competing to become doctors and engineers. Am I right or wrong? Yes. Because they know what is the value of that. How people respect in Japan, people respect the teacher more than the prime minister. The teacher have more dignity when they go to a restaurant or walk in the street and they know the teacher. Why? Because they started that 100 years ago. They started that after the atomic bomb or whatever, right? They started to focus on education. That's why that teacher is the one who taught the prime minister. Why not? He cannot become better than him. طبعاً. Teacher there becomes an area everybody competes to get in, because the teacher is the one who taught the doctors, the engineers, all of those. So teacher is on the top. A doctor comes to the teacher and bow down. An engineer comes to the teacher, you are above here. It's not a servant. It's not, where is, we pay your salary, man. What are you doing? When you, even if you did not say it, when you make the imams feel that, how are they going to guide you to Allah Azza wa Jal sincerely? How? Billah alaykum kayf. Kayf, when they read in the eyes of the people that I am paying your salary, you are our employee, you need to be such and such. Kayf yakun indu heart. And how he was going to have the heart to open their mouth and ya'mur bin ma'ruf wa nahy anil munkar. Kayf? How? How sincerely he tells you this is good for you, this is not good for you. How he laughs sincerely in your face and smile in your face and care about you. How? See how big is the issue? I'm sorry I diverted from the, but that's the importance of Seerah, right? To bring it to our life. This is what it is. You know, we can talk about the Seerah. And Rasulullah went to Medina and he built this and he built that. We know all of this. This is great. But how can we do it now? How can we do this mujtama' of al-Madina? We all talk about the Makki, the Madani, this and that, but we bring it in here. I need my children when they grow up in America that they have this Islamic education that make them respect and become a benefit and an asset for America. Yes. Yes. Our children are the ones who are going to take care of this place and take care of this country. Yes. And we're proud of that. That's what we need to start thinking along those lines. Bi-idhnillahi ta'ala. Masjid should have this awqaf. You are doing yourself a favor. I am doing myself a favor by being here tonight. Nobody, I'm not having a favor upon you, you're not having a favor upon me. We are all helping each other here. We are all benefiting. I am benefiting by sitting here and sharing the knowledge. And you are benefiting by listening to that knowledge and listening to the haqq, even it hurts sometimes. We all helping each other. من يبخل فإنما يبخل عن نفسه. ومن أساء فعليها. يعني whoever make حسنة فلنفسه. For yourself. And when you do this, for yourself also. So who benefits and who loses? Me and you. So it's not about who's the boss here. It is about, are we benefiting tonight or not benefiting tonight? Now, who's sitting here and who's sitting there? That is relative. يعني. Because I'll benefit from you somehow too. يعني you're getting something from me and I'm getting something from you. So, but nobody's better than anybody. It's like one time I'm saying, people, alhamdulillah, built this place. Other people pay money to run this place. And I am from the people who teach people who come in this place. And without you coming in this place, none of the above will have any value. Make sense now? يعني في ناس بنت هذا المسجد. Some people build this building. Right? But what is it What is the value if nobody is going to maintain it and make it continue? What is the value of that? No value, sir. It would be actually deserted and can collapse or used for a wrong purpose. Mabna mahjur. Tayyib, if you have the building and you have the maintenance, but no customers, then what? You have hospital top of the line, top notch, and the doctors, best doctors, but no patients. No patients. What are they going to do? واضح اخوانا I hope it is clear the lesson for tonight. Inshallah we'll stop here باذن الله تعالى, and next time inshallah we talk about the beginning of the hijrah to Medina. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us among those who are in the footsteps of al-habib al-rasul al-nabi sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam and his sahaba radwanullah alayhim ajma'in, walhamdulillahi rabbil alamin.